We're pleased to announce progressive political commentator Tom Hartman, now on weekday afternoons on KCAA.
Elections are not about swaying so-called undecided voters. They're about stirring up the base. The base will bring the undecided voters along with them. They'll do it through social media. They'll do it through talking to their neighbors. They'll do it by talking to people in the workplace.
Original thinker and activist Tom Hartman joins our lineup weekday afternoons here on KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM.
KCAA is your CNBC news affiliate. We're the station that gets down to business.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, sit back, relax, grab your favorite beverage, slip on those flip-flops, lock on that dial for a completely different kind of real estate radio show. It's time for the Flip-Flop Investor Show. It's not what you think. Here's Stephen McGee and Todd Bayer.
All right. Hey, everyone out there. How you doing today? It's Thursday, September 29th. And my name's Todd Bayer. With me, as always, is Stephen McGee. Say hello to everyone there, Steve.
Hi. Stephen. I'm all like trying to lean in over my busted arm into the microphone.
Yeah, you guys can't see it on the air right now, but Steve had a bit of a mishap last weekend, and he dislocated his elbow. It was a pretty gnarly scene.
It's actually really hard to do right here, so I managed to somehow perfectly hit the exact spot on my elbow on the corner of the curb.
Ouch. Yeah, it was beautiful. I got to pick him up and take him to the emergency room right before our Saturday morning coffee event on Saturday. So, this is the Flip Flop Investors Radio Show. We talk about real estate investing here locally in the Inland Empire. We talk about the flips. We talk about the flops. And every week we like to bring on some guests that, either seasoned investors or new investors. Today with us in the studio, we have Randy and Dina, a married couple here locally that are fairly new to the real estate investing game. But how you guys doing today?
Great. How are you?
We're doing great.
Doing great.
So for the people out there, I know a lot of people have heard about these like big real estate events that people do, like Robert Kiyosaki and, some of the like Christina Turek and people like that that are on TV. And they've gone to some of these events. And Stephen and myself, we are not involved in any of these groups, and we don't really know them. We've never been to them. So I always like to ask people, like, how did they end up getting involved? Because you guys did Robert Kiyosaki's legacy course, and how did you get in touch with the legacy thing to begin with?
Well, basically, it was me reading the book, Rich Dad Poor Dad. And once I read the book, I wanted to, learn more about what he was talking about. So I started going online, searching for new content, new books and things like that. And I kept coming across his website for Legacy. It kept coming up. And so I told Dina, instead of investing in the rat race, why don't we invest in real estate and go check out this education program?
So I need to write a book for the Inland Empire Real Estate Investment Club and then have a site where pop-ups show up all the time and say, come to the club, and then you want to pay for a seminar.
That's work.
Sweet.
I guess that's the idea, yeah.
And then when Randy came home and told me, what we were going to do, and I was like, what? Are you crazy? We don't have any money.
Yeah.
But that's not you can get money from these guys, so don't worry about it.
I mean, we didn't pay for the course.
Yeah, no, but
please don't call us for money for a legacy course.
No, that's not what I meant.
Shame. So the you guys took the legacy course, and
when was that?
Yeah, when did you do that?
That was last October. We started in the program, but we actually have certain classes that you take that you start off at. So our first class is actually in January.
Yes. So I think we talked about it before, and you said it's like a la carte. You pick the part of the program you want. What did you guys choose?
First off, they unfortunately force you into one of the classes that they start with. And that's true. I think that was wrong. I think they should allow you to pick every single class. But this class was specifically for beginners and to start you off. But then the second pick that we picked was wholesale.
Okay. And wholesaling, for people out there, is when you get a property under contract that you're going to buy as an investment, and instead of you buying it and closing on it yourself, you're assigning that contract to somebody else, and you effectively make a commission sort of. It's not really a commission because that's a real estate agent thing, but you get money for assigning that contract to somebody who ends up closing the transaction.
Exactly.
So how did you choose wholesale as your second course? Like, how did that become the thing you wanted to do?
That was just some advice that we had heard from, you know, investors that worked for Legacy, some of the teachers that worked for Legacy. When we took our first class, mm-hmm. They kind of moved us in that direction. But I wish we would have done like marketing first or something more that you could adapt to more easily. Because mm-hmm. wholesale, it's kind of like, I mean, it was a good class. It was a great class. The girl who taught it was amazing. She's been doing it for a really long time. But I just felt like you kind of need your basics, like what was the first class, and then maybe like marketing, like how to get the deals, because we weren't really ever, they kind of give you some idea, but you're kind of just thrown out there. So.
Okay, that makes sense. So, yeah. What did you take additional courses? Just those two?
We did. We took Fix and Flip, okay. Which gave us all the information that we would need to basics to start off and go out and start flipping properties.
Is just those three courses, or?
There's a lot more courses, but those are three that you get.
Those are the ones you prepaid for.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. One thing that we've gotten from all the different groups, all the different national sales organizations that bring new real estate investors to the game, they all end up telling them about these local real estate investment clubs, which is what got you guys to our club. You know, exactly. they told you to go out and find your local investment club, and you got to our club, which is the Inland Empire Real Estate Investment Club. We meet on the fourth Wednesday of every month at the Mission Inn in Riverside. We just had our meeting last night. We had a great attendance. We had like awesome. 126 people there.
That was the final number. Was. Okay.
Yep, great. 126. We had more people than that, but that's how many people paid. You know, we let a couple of people in because they help out, set up for the meeting and stuff.
Sure.
But, yeah, we do that every month, and you guys came out. Gosh, it was probably
June.
June. Yeah, I was going to say maybe May even, but so June, you guys came out, and
was that Aaron's meeting? Aaron Mazzarillo's meeting?
I can't remember. Horrible memory. But
was he before or after Chuck?
I can't remember.
But the reason I thought it'd be funny is if they go to these courses and teach wholesaling, and then you have like a master wholesaler in front of the audience.
Exactly.
Basically,
like,
telling
why
like,
did I do it?
Yeah, they're essentially he's telling the audience like, this is the hardest job in the industry, and you have to be incredibly good. You have to compete with me.
Right.
And then like all these people after that event were sort of discouraged. They're sitting around like, man, everybody told us to wholesale to start out, and this guy just punked us all from the stage. Mm-hmm. And he's like, go flip property. It's easy.
But, you know, what's funny is that, I mean, a lot of people get into the business and they're told to start out wholesaling. And what we've told a lot of people that come in saying that, it's like, why wholesale? You're cutting out the juiciest part of of the whole thing. So the hardest part is finding the deal. Once you find a deal, it's pretty easy to go from there to have a contractor come in, you know, an experienced person that knows how to work on houses, and they fix it for you. And, you know, that's the easy part, listing it for sale. A real estate agent handles that part. You don't have to, you know, field phone calls and write up contracts. That's, you know, somebody else's job. So wholesaling, it's like you're just giving away the best part of the whole deal to somebody else. So we've told a lot of people that. And I know you guys have kind of had like a
– absolutely.
You know, an epiphany realizing that – yeah,
to speak to that point, I mean, you know, with a lot of newer investors coming into the industry, they don't know anything about – like what you guys have to offer. Like, we had no idea what was out there. In fact, we didn't even know that meetings existed. So that was one of the great things that did come from that program. But the fact is that we actually found you guys by ourselves through Meetup.
Yeah.
Online. So that's the straight up truth. And we don't know as new investors that there's money out there to be found and how to find it. And I'm sure they teach a lot of that through Legacy, but we never heard any of that.
It's incredible how effective Meetup's been too at like getting people to the meeting.
Oh yeah,
absolutely.
So many people come in and say like, "Oh, I found you guys on Meetup," and I'm just so stoked it works that well because people show up because of it.
Well, and what I like about your guys' meeting is you're not trying to sell anything, because other meetings you go to, there's someone up on stage, you know, hey, buy this, do this, you know, follow me that, and you guys are just there to, you know, have people do the haves and wants, which I absolutely love. I think that's pretty cool. And then you interview someone, which is really neat. And you're not, you know, again, you're not trying to sell anything, which is very comfortable. You don't want to go there and you're trying to network, and then someone makes you uncomfortable by trying to sell you something. Exactly. You're like, come on, I've already, you know, it's for us, we've already put out enough money in education. And when you're, it's even at, you know, I hate to say that, but even at Legacy, when you go to lunch or whatever, they have someone up on stage trying to sell you something else, right, after you've already spent
Herbalife or something.
Yeah. You know, all this amount of money, and you're just like, really? Come on. Like, we're here to try to learn, and I don't want to buy another system. Like, I need to get this one down first.
Yeah.
Maybe we should note that, actually, we haven't mentioned the haves and wants. So at our meeting, we do a section called haves and wants. There, the North San Diego Club does that. And I think that's it.
Yeah, not many. There's a haves and wants at South San Diego, the one at the Scottish Rite
Center.
Oh,
yeah. That's a big
Bill
one.
Bill Tan's
too.
Old meeting. Yeah. That one, they do haves and wants. And they do it a little differently.
They limit it.
They're a huge club. Yeah, they have like 300 people every time. Yeah. So they, we got haves and wants from that. I mean, like we've talked about before, Steven and myself, we went to like 16 clubs a month at one point. Yeah. And not that we were trying to go out there for this purpose, but we ended up finding the things we liked best about each meeting. And that's what we brought to ours, because, you know, we were going specifically because we were looking for private investors, people that wanted to invest in deals. So if at one of the clubs, I remember one of them, they're like, raise your hand if you have money and you're looking for deals. You know, that was something we really liked. Like, we need to do that in our meeting, you know. And other things that we like to do is the haves and wants. Because if you have a deal, or if you have some kind of service or something you're trying to offer, you can't talk to everybody in the room, you know, and you may not even have as many business cards as there are people in the room. Like, I know myself, I would bring like 20 every time we go to a meeting. So
if you're new to the industry and you don't know what haves and wants are, haves and wants is when at a meeting you can openly either line up or pass the microphone, and you can talk about what you have or want. So I'm looking for a deal, I have cash, I have this real estate related service. And if you're anywhere in the country and you are looking for a local real estate investment club, make sure that they have haves and wants. I mean, make sure it's not a big pitch club, but haves and wants is a big it's a big boost. It really helps a lot of people get acclimated.
Absolutely. So, well, I guess since if you're just tuning in out there, we are the Flip Flop Investors Radio Show. We talk about real estate investing locally here in the Inland Empire, and also we talk about the flips, the flops, and you know, we usually talk to new people and people that are seasoned in the industry. Today in the studio, we have some newer investors. We have Dina and Randy with us today, and we're talking about how they got into the real estate investment business and sort of what they've learned to date and things that are going to help them into the future. So
they've been, I mean, you guys have been hanging in our office. Well, Randy Moore, Randy Moore, Dina's been in too. Like, you know, I'm sure, like, I remember the first day Randy came by the office, he's sort of like, all this goes on every day, and there's a lot of weird stuff that we do on a daily basis. So what have you found that's been the most shocking by hanging out with us just in the office?
Well, you know, I've learned quite a bit from you guys just by hanging out. And, you know, when you compare what we've learned from the actual school in comparison to actually hanging out with real investors that are actually out there pounding the pavement and doing deals and coming across different situations and looking at properties. But I'd say the most profound thing is really actually getting out there and looking at the properties and finding out some of the issues that can come along with that. And being out there listening to you guys run your business, actually run your business. I mean, that's the most profound thing so far.
Like, you guys, you both had some predispositions coming in, you
Absolutely.
Know, to the business. Like, did you, have you found anything that you, either through courses or through other people, thought things were a certain way and then later on realized they're not that way at all?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, just for example, the whole wholesaling thing that we just talked about. I mean, it came when I came to you guys and you offered your joint venture program. That was a huge difference to me. And from what Dean and I were being told, hey, go out and wholesale these properties. Find these properties, wholesale them, and make a fee off of each of these properties. Build your capital and then flip properties. This is what I was told and what we were taught in these classes. And so that was huge. That was like one of the biggest turning points to how we looked at our education from that point on.
So when we sort of explain that we don't use our own money and we use outside capital and you don't have to have your own, you kind of like your head exploded a little bit.
I was like, wow, this is real. I mean,
that was amazing.
Well, I mean, even in the beginning when I got started, I mean, I thought you had to have like cash. You had to have like hundreds of thousands of dollars sitting in a checking account.
Only rich people
go.
Can do this.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. Like it's such a huge barrier to entry, it seems like, in your mind. But when you get into it, you realize you don't need to have any money. You just need to know what you're doing, and or at least hire the right people that know what they're doing. I mean, as long as you can orchestrate a team, you can be a real estate investor. It's not at all difficult. This is an old industry. Real estate's been around since people have been around, you know.
Yeah.
We were talking about earlier today, there's probably some guy in the tribe or in the, you know, or in the community somewhere that would build these huts for people or something. I mean,
and barter the
trade, trade for it, you know.
Started.
There had to have been a guy that did that, you know.
But I like how open you guys are, and you're very refreshing, you know, when people need help, you're right there. I mean, you take our phone calls. I don't know about anyone else's, but
but never talked to anybody.
I always say, and I was telling this guy last night at the bar when we went after the meeting, that you know, by trade I'm an X-ray tech, and the way I learned was we did our basic education for like 3 months, and then we went to the hospital and did an internship. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of like a see one, do one type of person.
Right.
So I always tell him, like, I wish we could have done a program where we could have almost did like an intern where you learn your education and then you go out and you shadow an investor for a certain amount of time. And that just wasn't really available. They did have a mentor come out, a 3-day mentor.
I remember
and,
that.
You know, I'll give him, he's really nice, Rick Sigler. He's awesome. He's based out of Memphis, Tennessee.
Very knowledgeable.
Very knowledgeable, but he does lease options. And I, you know, lease options seems kind of hard out here in California. I know there's some people that are doing them, and that's awesome.
They're
awesome. They make really good money. And but for us just starting, it just seemed really overwhelming, and I wish we would have had maybe a mentor that was more like a fix and flip mentor or something a little more
so specific.
Yeah, more specific. Yeah. And I wish it would have been someone based in California.
Sure.
Versus, because then maybe come out for, you know, a while, or we could have shadowed him or, you know, just something more interny. But I guess that's just the way I kind of like things, you know, so.
That's tough, you know, because you got to, in a way, you have to find your own mentors, and you have to find, you know, and the club that we have certainly opens the doors for that. There's a lot of people there that are willing to help. It's not just us. I mean, we have a pretty busy schedule. It is. We try to help as many as we can, but you know, there's great websites like Bigger Pockets, and I know you guys have been on there.
Oh,
I know,
yes.
Randy, you've listened to tons of podcasts on there.
Oh, yeah, huge.
Yeah, and so that's, you know, for if you want information, like, get on biggerpockets.com. Like, that is a great website for you to go check out. And they got podcasts and forums, and if you ever have a question, no matter how dumb you think it might be, you get on there and ask the simplest question in your mind, and you'll get a ton of people responding to you. It's very beneficial, and you know, so if you're looking for somebody to flip, I mean, you know, one thing you might want to do is start looking for like a specific mentor. I mean, I know that we're helping out a lot too, but
you
know, we can't be there all the time as much as we'd like to be.
Right.
So, but
why not? I'm sure. Can't we just come to your office every day and like hang out?
You could. We just probably won't be there.
For sure. It'd be more for fun because of how much we laugh, but that's okay.
I know. So
it's supposed to be a fun business. That's the point.
Well, yeah, of course. You don't want to go. You don't want to be like, you know, boring. Yep. Let's clock in and clock out like we do.
Right.
We want to get out of that. That's why we're doing this.
Yeah, that's, you know, we're on that other track. We're on the, you know, there's that 9-to-5, you know, go to college, get married, have 2.4 kids, you know, and then go get a job with a solid company and, you know, get your pension and retire and then die. That's pretty much the plan for most people.
Just waiting to die.
And, you know, like we love being advocates for the other way of doing things, which is, you know, the entrepreneurial way of doing things. And we like it, but it's not for everybody. You know, we know people that it, you know, it just doesn't suit them. They prefer the comfort of knowing where their paycheck is coming from next week. And, you know, they love the comfort of that. And I'm more uncomfortable with that, which is weird, but, you know.
You know, there are people that come to us and they say that's exactly what they want, is they want to be their own boss and whatever, and they absolutely don't want that. We'll find investors that we'll be talking to, and they'll say, oh, I want to flip property. Great. You have to go do these things. And they hate the idea of doing the things we told them to do.
Right.
And so I say, well, you know, you've been working a while. You have a retirement account. You know, what do you do with the money? And then you find out that it's just been sitting in a money market account making nothing. Well, you know, you can invest that in somebody else's deal. And then they like that idea so much more, because then they put the money up from their retirement account. They get a good return. And then the person who found the deal, you know, gets to run the project, and then everybody wins. But those people still get to keep their very comfortable job that makes them feel secure. Mm-hmm. In the meantime, accomplish the same goal they set out to get.
Got it.
And so it's like a fast forward to the lifestyle they're looking for in a different way.
Yeah. Yeah, wow. And we've talked about it. We talked about it last night when you interviewed Jessica. We talked about things you need to do in your daily routine in order to be successful. And when you're an entrepreneur, it doesn't mean you don't work. It just means you set your own schedule. Yeah. But you do have to set a schedule, you know?
That's right.
So, talk a little bit, guys, about what you've done to change your schedules around, because you're working full-time still, mm-hmm. but then you also are doing this on the side. So obviously you guys are regimenting it out a little bit. So talk a little bit about how you've changed your like evening routines and things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. So we recognized early on really quickly that we'd have to set up some sort of system, because otherwise you're just flailing around like a fish out of water and not really getting anything done. Yeah. You know, and so like I told you guys before, I was over-educating, and I found myself just sitting there reading and delving into information that I really need, and looking up the clock, and it's 2-3 hours later going, oh my, I really didn't get anything done.
Yeah.
So we started putting this system together where Dina makes the offers through a buyer's agent, mm-hmm. and I'm working on other projects like trying to find properties. I was going door to door at one point, handing out cards, just talking to people. I'm also working on probate. I learned and taught myself how to pull probate offline.
Mm-hmm.
And then we started working on mail programs that you and I talked about.
Yeah.
Probably wasn't such a great idea.
It's a good way to burn some money.
we did waste a lot of time.
Yeah, and I mean, but you might look at it as like a waste of time, but
there was a lot of learning.
Yeah, you learn from that.
And
you know,
absolutely.
And I think Steve and I, we were talking earlier today about all the stuff that we've done. You know, if you go through our shared file folder on our computer, you know, if you go through that thing, you'll see like a boneyard of like stuff that we never used or never came to be. You know?
We need to put out our first investor video. we have a video we made. And it was, man, we had a grandiose plan, let me tell you.
Oh, boy.
Like, oh, I spent, what do you think, like a week doing this presentation?
Yeah.
And then we went through with a fine-tooth comb. Todd's like, change this. And then as a team, we came up with all these specific objectives that it had to have. Mm-hmm. And then so it was like a month by the time we were done with this thing, right? So I built this – and. Mind you, this is a 15-slide presentation.
Yeah.
Like, this isn't like hundreds of slides. But we wanted to be really concise.
Right. Mm.
And we got to the point where we had to do a voiceover. We wanted this video. And so Todd has, you know, the radio voice. I sound like a guppy. So we write, like, Todd sits at the computer and writes a script. It's like we talk back and forth about it. And then we record it. It turned out pretty good.
Yeah.
It is useless. It is a really good, useless crap presentation that like no one is ever going to see. But I want to put it, we'll like cut the promised return out of it because it can't be public.
Right.
But I want to put this out for people to see like where we started versus what we do now. And it doesn't even resemble. It like some of the slides have some content, but it doesn't even resemble what we do now. So
wow.
And that's only 2 years or 2.5 years. So
amazing how much can change.
Yeah. So like a decade, I mean, is even more. I mean, so in the first year, you guys will have an entirely different perspective and plan than you start out with in, you know, the beginning of the year.
It'd be cool to think back about, you know, all of the little tasks and things that we wasted our time on and all the little jobs we were trying to do and found out they were wrong.
But they were like, they're not even wrong, because we found that like, so we'd present this stuff and then we get feedback. And then make a change.
Right.
Present, test, refine, test, refine, test, mm-hmm. refine. And so none of it was a waste. It was just you couldn't get to a result unless you had a place to start where people could tell you you're doing it wrong. You couldn't get the advice to get the best thing first. It wasn't possible. Mm-hmm. So even that, like in raising our own capital, that was a huge, huge learning curve for us.
I bet.
Yeah, that's the tough thing. I mean, when you're trying to be creative about something, and like, you know, we're pretty creative people as it is, but you know, when you're trying to create something from scratch, you're like, what is this even supposed to look like? Like, what are, you know, what are we even trying to accomplish with this thing? And you know, you have to put yourself in the shoes of the investor, the person that's going to, you know, lend you money to do deals with, you know, and you have to say, like, what do they want to know? What do they need to know? You know, and then how do we present it in a way that's logical and makes sense to them? And, you know, most people are going to have questions. So how do you answer most of those questions ahead of time?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And, you know, like, then how's it supposed to even look? What picture should we put here? You know, like, building a presentation is pretty tough. I mean, when you get into it. And even at the end, we go back and look at it after we've produced the whole thing.
Yeah.
Like,
oh,
this is the worst piece of garbage we've ever put out. You know,
oh, no. it's just like the coolest thing, though, that we do still have to this day is the Wile E. Coyote style blueprint cartoon that explains how real estate investments work. And it's a single page with like less than 20 words on it and drawings.
Yeah.
It's great.
It looks like a Wile E. Coyote blueprint.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah, like awesome. Like a rock would drop on one of these stick characters on it at some
you
point.
Got Acme, cool. Acme investors.
Seriously, it exactly. says in the bottom corner, like Rehab Loan Group, like right. in, with a little marker as if it's at Acme. We made it look just like it. Total.
That's cool.
Yeah.
And people responded to it. Everybody liked that thing because it was different. It wasn't their and that's, I think that's a piece of advice we could really give people early on is look different. Like the whole blue right. ocean strategy, be different. We did something that looked different than everybody else was doing. You know, wearing t-shirts, sure. that weird Wile E. Coyote cartoon, a whole bunch of stuff that didn't look like anybody else.
Well, we were trying to explain a very simple concept. Flipping houses is a simple concept.
Yeah.
Lending money to people that flip houses is a simple thing. So we're trying to explain a simple thing complexly.
Yeah.
We had to make our presentation more complex. So it didn't seem like it was that easy.
Because it really is.
It really is that easy. So the blueprint, it was so easy to make because it really is that easy. We could do it with a very simple one-page drawing. But, you know, there's this pressure we have to put on some kind of a presentation. So
yeah.
that's really why we put the whole thing together. And, you know, all the other stuff in there was just fluff, really. I mean,
just to make you feel better about making the decision.
Yeah.
You were like, oh, I'm going to put my money in this deal. Well, now I feel better about it because I have a little more knowledge. So it wasn't like they were giving up control completely to us.
Right.
You know, you're supposed to defer in any business to the expert. Like, I don't bother my CPA about my taxes are done, right? He just does them, and then I write a check if I have to. I mean, it's...
You've had to write checks?
No. I said it with...
Checks.
I think... we won't go down that path. but I mean, the joys of being self-employed, right?
Right.
It's
just expensive.
It's really
every year I spend
operate.
A lot of money Me to too. Operate my business.
Me too. So the... I lost my train of thought. You screwed me up with the texting.
Yeah. We're talking about checks. Yeah, well, you were talking about hiring an expert, essentially.
Yeah, so
not micromanaging.
They wouldn't. Yeah, they. So we have very few people in a deal ever even ask us what's going on. We just collect money and then send them a check back or wire back at the end with a return. But there are some people who want to go through a logical process. They can't just trust you. And I wouldn't expect anybody else to just trust me. So you have to give them like a bunch of data so they feel like the decision they're making is the right one. I don't actually know. I mean, we've given people some pointers, but I don't know if there's a way of telling the difference between what we think we're trustworthy, us, versus someone who isn't. They all look the same, except for reputation. Mm-hmm. And that's really hard for people to figure out.
Yeah, the reputation, that's something that takes a long time to build. And
yeah.
a lot of it is just showing up and being present, you know. And hey, if you're just tuning in, this is the Flip Flop Investors Radio Show right here on KCAA, NBC News Talk Radio. Every week we talk about the real estate investing locally here in the Inland Empire. Every week we have on either a seasoned veteran pro in real estate investing, or sometimes we bring on people that are new to the industry. Today in the studio we have Dina and Randy talking about their experiences in real estate thus far. They're fairly new to the business, but are out there making it happen. And you guys are writing quite a few offers lately.
Yes.
I know you've been really cranking them out.
I just sent 17 offers on Tuesday.
Man, and that's, you know, that's a good volume. Like, that's...
Yeah, I'm going to crank that up some more, I think.
Good plan.
I have, you know, I have my job, it's sometimes it's busy, sometimes it's not. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I have some downtime, and if I have downtime, I'll be on my phone and looking for deals. So
you guys both have a fair, not flexible schedule, but you work less days than most people, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have now Thursday, Friday, Saturday off. So
yeah,
at least I do have some time to get out there and shake hands and talk to people, and that's important. I know that for a new investor, and what you guys have taught us and what we've seen is a high percentage of a brand new investor's success rate is being able to network with experienced investors and people that know what they're doing out there. And so that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing here with you guys. And we've had a lot of fun doing it, and a lot of success, a lot of education has come out of this.
Yeah. And absolutely. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, networking is very, very important in real estate, because you got to assemble your team. And, you know, I know we've talked about it, working with family and things like that, too. Like, they need to understand what you're doing.
That's right.
Everybody around you needs to be to understand what you're doing, because otherwise you're going to get faced with some pushback. A lot of people are.
And we have.
Yeah. Yeah. It happens, you know.
Yeah, they look at us like we're crazy.
These are the naysayers.
It hasn't changed for me in 14 years, and I don't think for Todd in about the same amount of time. It hasn't changed.
Yeah.
Even with how much experience you have.
Doesn't matter.
Wow.
Or how much success.
No, like, even I was 10 years into, even just not I was doing regular home sales to begin with, but investor deal finding, there were only two people in the entire world that listened to me in 2009, my brother and my sister. They're the only people that bought a home. And both of them realized $200,000+ in equity, like in the home they live in. And everybody else told me I was an idiot. I had already been doing that for like 5 years at that point, and I had worked for one of the top two, because Mike and Lance both had, they were the two major brokers, Mike Novak Smith and Lance Martin in Marina Valley. So I worked for one of them, for Lance, and we had access to the best properties at the cheapest prices in mass, and no one took me up on it. Now, investors did.
I did.
Well, Todd, yeah, hold on. But you had that, you and your mom came to that conclusion on your own. It didn't involve me.
No.
I was trying to get, like, your mom is now 40-plus year SRA appraiser who's just retiring.
Mm-hmm.
She has the experience. So you guys had a plan going into the market. The people that, like, that was logical. Everybody else, they wouldn't take my advice. Like, no one cared. All of my friends, extended family, no one thought I had any idea what I was talking about. And so
you're still going through that.
It's the same thing. And that was year five, and it's no different year 14.
Yeah.
So real estate really is just or is it the money part that's just really people are sensitive about that?
I think you hear about it on TV. I mean, people like Carlton Sheets used to have infomercials.
That was,
you know,
back in
Tommy
the day,
Vu
yeah.
and
oh, so good.
Oh, Dave Del Dotto. Yeah. You know, like, these guys had their like things on TV, and they're selling their tapes and whatnot. Yeah, they were tapes, not even CDs. Yeah. They were tapes.
They were definitely tapes.
And you know, you'd go out and do their little programs. I mean, it's kind of similar to what you guys got involved in, but you know, I mean, these things have been around for a while, and most people look at them as like get rich quick schemes.
Exactly.
And it's the wrong way to look at them, because they're not get rich quick schemes.
No, it takes a long time.
Yeah. Like there's a saying in real estate, which is you'll make money in real estate in 5 years. It just won't be your first 5 years.
Right.
That's what people say. And it's, you know, it's true. I mean, in the first 5 years, you're just trying to find your footing, and
you're making a living.
Yeah. You're making a living. Yeah. But you can't retire off it yet.
Well,
you
know? I think for most people too, like, knowledge is power. So if you have knowledge, you feel powerful.
Yeah.
And if you don't have the knowledge, you feel powerless.
Right. Yeah.
And so, you know, what you don't know scares you.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people, like, when you're saying you're giving people advice, they're like, this guy's crazy, because they don't know what you know. And so they're like, really, it's like tiptoeing, like, oh, I don't know if I should do it. I don't know. You know, so it's kind of like how I felt, you know, when Randy said he wanted to start doing this, I was like, we don't have any money. Like, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Not because I didn't know that you could do it without your own money. And so now that I know these things, now I'm like really into it. Like, I love looking for deals and I love going on my phone and I love making offers where, you know, like 6 months ago, I probably wouldn't have done any of that stuff. And I will say, if I could give any advice just from being someone new, is the networking is huge, because I feel like that's what kind of changed it for us and made things like click for us was the networking. Whereas before June, we weren't really doing any networking. So once we started coming to your meetings and talking to people, it really made us feel more comfortable and it gave us more knowledge. And now we've hung around with you guys. And I just, you know, I know it's right there. It's just right there.
That's a lot of it. You know, like the club itself is great for that reason almost alone.
Yeah.
Is that exactly. You have a group of people every month to get together and prove to each other that we're all not crazy.
Yes.
You know, this is actually something that really works and people are there doing it, you know, and it's like, I mean, we get a charge out of it every time. I mean,
yeah.
You know, for
that's
us,
how I keep doing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We love talking to new people too, because, you know, like, it's not that it's a job for Steve and I, it's not like it's mundane or anything, but you know, like to have new people come in, they're real excited about the potential and the prospect of it all. And they're absolutely right. But, you know, like it's cool to feed off their energy a little bit because, you know,
we take it in all the time.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It keeps you guys motivated too.
Oh,
I'm sure.
Pumped. Totally. Like we get pumped going, like that's we'll awesome. Go to lunch. It's almost hilarious how exhausting the lunch is with somebody new. Because the energy level is so high for like 2 to 3 hours.
Right.
And we come back to the office like, not only did I just like suck down a bunch of carbs, right? Like if I didn't have a beer, but like also we're speaking with somebody new with enthusiasm level, like far greater than we deal with on a daily basis, because it's like we're just taking in all their energy. And then we come back to the office, and usually lunch days, and that's why lately we haven't done lunches, because Todd and I have to be really productive right now. We're just like, and it's, you know, 3 o'clock. You're just like
mentally.
Oh man, because you just gave everything, but then you took in all the energy, and it was like cycling, and then you got out of it, and it's almost adrenaline.
Yeah.
Where you leave, and you're like, man, I just got like pumped, it's like off that person I was talking to.
Yeah, and we went to lunch. Randy, Dina, and myself. We went out. It was probably like in June, I guess. It was a little while ago.
It was right after it came to the meeting.
Yeah, it was like within 2 weeks, yeah.
Yeah, we went out to the Salted Pig there in Riverside.
I love that place. That
place is great, man. Salted we haven't pig? Been there in a little while, but...
Yeah, place is so good.
So we went out there, and like when you guys had a ton of questions, which was great. I love when people come with questions, because otherwise we're just kind of sitting there looking at each other like, okay, you know, what are you trying to get into? And we haven't done any lunches for a little while, but I think... We're doing our first one in a little bit tomorrow.
Well, I finally got that email done I've been working on.
Yeah.
If you listen to the show, and this is within a reasonable timeline, what day is September 29, 2016? Mm-hmm. So if you're listening to this as an archive, it may or may not be up. But we have an email. If you go to crg.email, there's a sign-up form. And I put together an email that basically has just a giant list of resources that we've compiled over the years. And so it's like... spreadsheet on how we analyze deals and 40 plus ways to find a deal and a presentation on how to get started and a sample contract. And the idea is to give people everything they need to actually get going. So if you're listening to this and you're like, where do I start? It's actually like an instructional email, because we're going to those lunches and people were asking us a lot of questions that were very basic.
Right.
And you can only say them with enthusiasm so many times, right? I like the creative stuff. Like, give me your creative problem. I can't wait to solve it. But, like, somebody's like, where do I find a deal? I'm like, well, you can do it a bunch of ways. And then so you start repeating yourself.
And then you start telling people, have you downloaded my 40 plus ways to find it? Yeah.
So now we just say, hey, sign up here, and you'll get everything. And then we can go on with lunch with all the questions that fill in. And so that's what I'm excited to get
back to
is take somebody who has all that knowledge we put out to them, and then they'll have questions for us.
Makes sense.
And just make sure that you're doing your own work.
Yeah.
Don't expect, you know, Steve and Todd to be doing any work for you, because that ain't going to happen.
Right. Yeah.
Go find your own leads. Do your own stuff. And
make an attempt to figure it out.
Right. Don't just go to them and be like, so, got a deal for me? You know?
You give me a deal? I'm sorry. If we get a deal, we're going to do it ourselves. Yeah. Right? We don't wholesale, actually. You know, we'll believe it.
Yeah.
I'm glad you mentioned leads, because I think a lot of people don't understand that this is a sales business.
Yes.
You know,
absolutely.
It's real estate investment. That's the vehicle. But, I mean, at the end of the day, we're selling property, we're buying property, we're negotiating for property. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of times you're out there, you're meeting all these people, and they may not be ready to sell their property today, but they're going to be selling their property sometime in the next 50 years, probably. Mm-hmm. So that's a lead you've captured. You know, when you knock on that door and they say, oh, we're not interested in selling, but, you know, maybe you got their name and number and you know their address already. So, you know, you can come back and follow up with them a month later. Are you guys using any kind of like a lead system, any kind of a way to keep track of?
We were given a really, actually a really cool marketing system called REI Black Book through our purchase.
Right.
And it actually helps you comp out properties. It helps you to hold all leads. Anybody that you put their phone number into the system, it holds it for you. It does a lot. It does quite a bit. It's a really cool marketing program. But that's really the only thing that we've used so far. But there has been other suggestions, like from Steve.
Pipe Drive,
yeah, that was another one. To be honest with you, I haven't really had a chance to sit down and look at it. But we're going to definitely put together something that fits in our program too. Yeah.
And then really, all you need is a calendar.
Right.
All you actually need is a calendar.
Sure.
And whatever person you talk to, you write down their name, their number, and notes about the property in your calendar. You call them on that day in the future. You just pre-schedule it. But the sales systems, they sure make it a lot easier.
Oh yeah. Big time. That's a big tool.
Unrequisite reminders. Sorry, go ahead.
I know I've like Googled, you know, lead searches and stuff like that, but I haven't really come up with anything like concrete. So I feel comfortable for me doing it through a buyer's agent. But the more I learn and the more I know, maybe that'll change. Who knows? But for right now, that's what I'm doing. I wasn't doing that before, so at least I'm doing that. And also, I think we've talked about getting a tax delinquent list, maybe doing that. So we're just trying to expand and see what we can do. More
from the 40+.
40+ ways to find a deal.
40 yes,
plus. It's going to be like 50. The goal really is, I'm not going to promise this because we promise enough stuff that we can't get to, but we're just overwhelmed, man. We, you know what? That reminds me. We really need to get that application up for an assistant like yesterday.
We do. Yeah.
I was wondering about that.
We'll do that tonight.
Yeah. The goal is to, at some point, compile all these ways to find a deal into a list of over 100 and, like, just put out a book. So when somebody says, hey, how do I find a deal? I just whip the book at their head at 20 miles an hour and say, good luck.
Yeah.
Let me know which one you like.
Throw the book at you. It's like that movie Whiplash, you know, where he throws the chair at him because he's not matching the beat properly.
That is usually the first barrier to entry. People always say, well, where am I going to find one of these?
Yeah.
And they use it as an excuse to not get started. And so, like, I want it to be about the size of a Frisbee with hard corners so that it, like, really sinks in.
That's definitely going to sink in.
I couldn't. Damn.
So, anyways, if you're just tuning in out there, this is the Flip Flop Investors Radio Show right here on KCAA, NBC News Talk Radio. We every week on Thursdays at 4, we talk about real estate investing here locally in the Inland Empire. We talk with new investors and seasoned investors. Today in the studio, we have Dina and Randy, and we're talking about their experiences in real estate so far. And one thing I do envy about you guys, and I wanted to say it before we get off the air, is that you guys still have your jobs. And there's some people out there that like to just jump in full force and quit their job, you know, which is pretty scary because it doesn't, you know, like you don't produce an income in real estate investment immediately,
right.
You know, and a lot of people get in, they're so excited and so pumped to do it that they think they're going to make $1 million by the end of the year. And they're not. I mean, I don't like to be a person that says you're not going to be able to do something, but you know, it's very unrealistic to think that you're going to do that.
So gotta be realistic. Yeah.
It's good that you guys at least are keeping your base income. So that way you guys don't have to, you know, have that to be concerned about. But it's tough, you know, to like manage your time and being able to work in the rest of it after working a full day.
It is. And plus, and we definitely thought about that. Trust me, I definitely thought about, I'm going to need to do this full time in order to get anything done. Because, you know, I'm up at 1:30 and to my job, I go do a 10 to 12 hour shift and then I come home and work in the business.
Yeah.
But it is kind of tough on you physically, mentally, because you're exhausted. But I could see how, you know, other investors that we've talked about, I can see how that turned into a major problem. Like Lauren Hardy, for example, she mentioned that she actually quit her job and then didn't get another lead for 6 months.
Yeah.
So she was buried in bills.
Yeah.
And so that had to be some serious stress.
Well, I haven't had a job for so long. I have almost no frame of reference, right? Like I haven't had a job since I was 20 years old or something like that. But, you know, I noticed, you'll notice that people that keep their job and they learn to work around their job become far more effective real estate investors, and then eventually they get rid of their job,
right?
Because they've deployed sort of the 4-hour work week type strategies, where, you know, in the book, The 4-Hour Work Week, Tim Ferriss proposes the question, what would you do if today your doctor came to you and said, you can't work more than 10 hours a week or you'll die of a heart attack, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you choose to look at real estate investing from that standpoint, meaning sticking to your job and limited mm-hmm. to the spare 10 hours you have a week, what can you do in that time and what will be most effective? It changes the decisions you make. Todd and I, like, we could make a lot of just nonsense decisions. And I mean, sometimes we're just screwing around in the office, like, because we can. We have this time, right?
Through paper and airplanes.
Well, you know, we get.
Not yet, but maybe.
I mean, we could. Yeah. We got it across the hall. But we enjoy just sort of talking about the potential of the business. And right. a lot of times we're sitting around talking about, wouldn't it be cool if, right? We're still dreamlining.
And
right.
we all do that, yeah.
But it's not productive, right? I mean, maybe right. mentally, but it's not immediately productive. If you're stuck in that 10-hour window, you are forced to be absolutely productive during that time period or you produce no results. So that's sort of a bonus that you guys get out of keeping your job. I mean, obviously, when you have kids, you have to, like, really keep a secure,
absolutely.
Secure household. I mean, you're if you keep that mentality and drop the job, you'll have a hell of a lot of time to do whatever you want.
Yeah. It's hard to work around our jobs. I'm not going to lie. It's some nights, like you said, some nights you're so exhausted and mm-hmm. you just don't want to do anything. And then, of course, we have a little guy at yeah. home, and he's, you know, he says mama about a billion times a day. So I'm in the, you know, bedroom, and he's sitting right next to dad in the living room. He walks all the way around just to tell me to help him open something. You know, and I'm like, you're sitting right next to your dad. Just things like that, you know, or if I'm on the computer trying to work and he's like, mama, mama, constantly, you know.
Yeah.
I love you, Nohea. But but yeah, it gets really hard, but we have a plan. We already know what's going to happen, how we're going to do it. You know, it just got to do it.
Yeah.
You just can't be sitting around doing nothing. You have to work at it.
What's cool as though is that she's all in with me.
You yeah. know,
and we work together well as a team. In life in general, but in this business, I would see how you definitely need that. That's why I admire what you guys have. You guys have a really good team.
Well, you get one or the other. Okay. Yeah, well, it's like, so me and Todd have each other to rely on. And
put a ring on it.
Yeah. But I mean, we go home and you know, the spouses have their problems from their job. And so yeah. we'll talk to them about what they did at their job and what, you know, what we did at ours. But we get to come and just complain at each other. And so it's almost like,
that's true.
So it's one of two things. If you're married and you, or take, I shouldn't say married, I'm not old and think that everybody has to be married. It's ridiculous. Yeah. If you're a couple and you can work together, that's phenomenal. But you have to be able to shut it off, like, to just have, like, you time. But if you can get excited, like, pumped on the same thing together, then yeah. Then even the complaints become a part of the relationship. Mm-hmm. So, like, Todd and I, we just – some days we're just complaining about crap in the industry. But then neither of us are going home other than just like, oh, this happened, and losing our mind with our spouses because we got to, like, get it out of each other in the office.
Yeah, I get that, definitely.
Yeah, we don't, like – I think my wife, you know, she ends up leading most of the conversation when yeah. we go home because yeah. she's got stuff that happens every day at her yeah. her office. So she's got all the cool stories. And for me, I'm just like, oh, man, I, you know, sat there and crunched out a bunch of emails for 4 hours. I mean, you know, where's the excitement in that?
Like, I didn't know that Sheila took the last candy bar.
Yeah, I know.
That's what I sort of hear. My girlfriend works for the DA, and so I get to hear it. So – this happened today, and then there's this crazy case of this, and it's like cops in my house for like an hour. I can hear like what's going on in the city of Riverside.
That's cool.
And so it's a totally different break from what you do on the daily, and it's almost nice. And then in the same aspect, like, you guys get to talk to each other about it. It's very difficult to go home and talk to your spouse about what you're excited about. You're like, hey, I had this big win, and they can be really excited about the win, but they don't necessarily understand why. Mm-hmm. So it's like there's both sides of that table are beneficial as long as they're working right for you.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So let's talk a little bit about goals, because in this industry, you got to set some goals. So what sort of goals have you guys set for yourselves? Like by
you,
the end of the year.
You want to take this a bit? I mean,
tell
in your
them, tell
in
them
your
what you have
board.
On your bulletin board.
Oh, there we go. Oh, I like a bulletin board. It's like a dream board.
Well,
I love
first
it.
Of all, we do have a goal to make a vision board.
Cool.
That was a goal last Sunday.
Yeah, last Sunday.
Nice.
Not together, but separately, just to kind of see.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, just to kind of see what we each come up with. We even said we should have my son do one, like just for fun.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
I think it'd be kind of cool to see that. But then he put something on the bulletin board like a month ago.
It's like make $200,000 by January.
Yeah. That's great goal.
Well,
it
see,
is.
Buy four deals.
Yep.
Hurry up.
There you go.
Get
right?
to work.
Deals,
that's
get
it.
Moving on it. Yeah.
We're still in September. You can buy one in September, one in October, November, and one in December.
Yeah, I better
there you go.
Leave right now.
Yeah, exactly.
Tomorrow. Tomorrow is Saturday, and it's the end of the month, so we better hurry up in one day.
Yes.
Definitely. So that's your January goal. Do you guys have a goal like by next year, like year end next year or something? I mean, do you have a goal in mind of when you think you might actually be able to either go down to one person having a job or maybe both of you not having a job? Is that part of your goals?
Yeah, and we've definitely discussed that. But to be honest with you, we're really sort of focused on the goal of just landing our first deal.
Yeah.
And
good.
And that's got to be our focus right now.
Absolutely.
In order for us to succeed.
But the plan is... The plan is for him to probably go out first.
Okay. Right?
That's the plan.
Because you're the outside sales guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I have a lot more experience than over 20-plus years in sales, and so shaking hands with people is my thing. I love doing that. She likes to do paperwork.
Yeah, it's a good trait.
I love paperwork. Yeah.
I don't love doing it. I'm just good at it.
Yeah, I'm good at it, too. I think that's why I like doing it. Like, I don't mind sitting at a desk and doing – as long as I'm doing something productive, I don't mind doing it.
Yeah.
You know? I think it's great.
See, that's how Todd talked me back into this again. I was like, oh, I don't want to do hard money lending anymore. I'm just going to go buy a property on my own. He goes, what if I did all the paperwork? And I was like, all right, you got me.
All right, fine.
Yeah, yeah.
That
I don't
would
even
be
do
me.
That.
I said the same thing. I'll do all the paperwork. You can, you know, go out and talk to people, and I'll do all the other stuff. That'd be great.
Yeah, I like it. It works. I mean, you know, everybody has to bring their own unique talents to the group. I mean, you know, we've talked a little bit in the past. Like, it's been Steve and I doing stuff primarily for a while. We've been doing deals together since, 2006?
Yeah.
And so, for us, we've talked about, like, how do we bring another person in? Like, do we bring in another one of us? Like, you know, or do we need to start specializing certain positions and saying, okay, this person handles bookkeeping, this person handles, you know, accounts payable, or, you know, like,
I thought that's what you guys were looking more towards.
We are.
Yeah.
It's, but that's, you know, that's our current mindset. I mean, if we're talking about goals that we've set, that's where we are. It's like we really need to get people to
specialize
in certain things, you know.
You give up a piece of the deal in exchange for a specialist in some specific area. So whether it's, you know, $400 for a transaction coordinator that puts together all the paperwork on the purchase and the resale, or, you know, whether it's a bookkeeper, we pay a couple $100 fee a month to handle that stuff. And we're even looking at, like, accounts payable, people who write checks for us and, you know, handle all utility accounts. I mean, utility accounts are becoming overwhelming right now.
Yeah. I mean, every day in the mail, I get check, you know, bills for different utilities for all the different properties we got going on now.
Yeah. I remember you got a
$1,600
water bill.
$1,650. Yeah. And it turns out that was a legitimate water
bill. Yeah. We checked the meter and everything. Yeah. It was legit.
It was legitimate.
How is that legit?
Because apparently in LA County, if you water your plants, they really like to make you pay for it.
Are you serious?
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll show
you
the
letter. That's like a rent payment.
It is.
That's a mortgage payment for some people.
It is.
For a lot of people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we just have a little patch of lawn, you know, and some trees.
I'm totally serious. There's like what? There's, you know, it's a higher end home. So, I mean, there's, like 200 or like 100 and something Australian hedges and big patch of lawn. And I think like another 100 boxwoods. And, you know, there's a bunch of dirt. And then our summers in LA hit 100 plus degrees.
Right.
And our Australian hedges started dying. And so we had to put like a soaker line on them and run it four times a day. Well, apparently running a soaker hose four times a day.
In a drought?
In a drought. It doesn't go over well with the city of LA. And
kind of expensive.
We used about the equivalent of a small public holding tank of water on the landscaping.
I remember Todd
describing
how that would be measured. And that was really interesting, but a lot of money later.
Yeah. Wow. So apparently we did use that much water. Well, we don't have a whole lot of time left. I think we're, you know, getting close to the end of the hour here. I mean, is there anything you guys specifically want to ask or anything like that with the last couple minutes we got here?
You want to take this one, maybe in your
or any,
phone
any,
voice.
Any wisdom to impart?
My phone voice?
Yeah. My name's Dina, and I'll flip your condo.
There you go.
Wow. This turned into a really different show.
What are you talking about?
No, you know, I really don't have any questions at this moment that I can think of, because I feel like I'm always asking you guys, you know, questions all the time. So I'm actually good right now.
Well,
I'm
sweet.
Good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's knock out the calendar.
All right. Yeah. So let's see. Coming
12th?
Up. Yep. On October 12th, we have that's our next event that we're going to be doing. That is a happy hour event we'll be doing at the Bar and Grill Company in Yucaipa, starting at 5 o'clock until 8 o'clock-ish.
Yep.
That's on October 12th. Then on, October 21st. We should have brought a calendar. We always do this.
The last Wednesday this month.
Yeah, the last Wednesday of October.
It's the 26th.
26th. Yes. I think you're right. That's going to be our next investment club meeting at the Mission Inn, starting at 6:30 p.m. till about 9 o'clock. We have, and the Saturday right before that will be our Saturday morning coffee event, which will be at Molino's Coffee once again in Riverside. And
that'd be the 22nd if we back up 4 days from there.
The 22nd. So that's it for us this week, and we appreciate everybody tuning in. Be sure to tune in to us again next week on Thursday at 4 o'clock for the Flip Flop Investors Radio Show. Have a good week, everybody.
Bye-bye.
D-I-E.
This is 1050 AM KCAA Loma Linda and 106.5 FM Yucaipa.
A report says Amazon could start leaving packages inside your house when you're not around. The information says the e-commerce giant is partnering up with a connected lock company and a connected garage door company that could allow delivery people temporary access to drop off packages. The companies would offer their in-home delivery services when you're checking out on Amazon. YouTube Go will now let you take your viewing offline. The new app allows users to save videos for offline viewing, giving options over quality and file size, so it's clear how much data a download will use. The app also allows for local sharing with nearby users without using any data. Spotify's making you another mixed tape. The streaming music company introducing Daily Mix, a new personalized playlist full of songs Spotify thinks you'll want to listen to. People with a large library can have up to 6 different mixes, while most users will have between 1 and 3. Each mix is loosely arranged around a mood or genre and may contain up to 5,000 songs. Tech Report, Larry Olson, NBC News Radio.
NBC News Radio, I'm Tom Roberts. New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is confirming one person is dead and 108 injured in this morning's commuter train crash in Hoboken. Christie called the crash during the morning rush hour an extraordinary tragedy.
This train came in at a high rate of speed into the station and crashed through all of the barriers, bringing it right to the interior wall of the Hoboken terminal.
Christie said the train's engineer was hospitalized in critical condition but was cooperating with law enforcement officials. The train was not equipped with a safety system that would have monitored its speed. The technology automatically slows down trains that are going too fast or that fail to obey a signal. The State Department is working to release information from over 1,800 additional pages of Hillary Clinton's emails just ahead of Election Day. A federal judge ordered the department to process the emails because of a Freedom of Information Act request. You're listening to the latest from NBC News Radio.
From the KCAA Weather Center, I'm Tom Ladd. For this afternoon, it'll be mostly sunny. Expect a high near 91. Cloudy tonight with a low of 65. A west wind 10 to 15 and gusts as high as 25 expected. Friday's outlook, it'll be sunny. Expect a high near 89. Clear Friday night with a low near 63. For Saturday, it'll be sunny. Expect a high of 86. And Saturday night, clear with a low of 59. That's your weather forecast for this hour from KCAA 106.5 FM. And 10:50 a.m. The stations that leave no listener behind.
It's back, back in downtown San Bernardino, just the way it all began. This weekend, it's time to get back to the root, Route 66.
Get back to where you once belonged. Nobody rendezvous better than San Bernardino, and it's back in downtown San Bernardino just the way you like it. This weekend, this Saturday, October 1st from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m., 1,000 cars already entered and more to come. Block after downtown block full of America's legendary iron. Delicious food, fun, entertainment, and most of all, your favorite all-American city, San Bernardino. Stronger than ever. Be a part of the fun. KCAA will be at the corner of 5th and G with chances to win family fun packs of tickets to the zoo worth $300. For more info on the route, go to winwithkcaa.com. That's winwithkcaa.com. And get back to Route 66 this weekend.
They had a foolproof plan.
It's election time.
First we find a bad candidate.
But wait, he's got to be the worst candidate in history. A real train wreck.
I will build a great, great wall.
Well, actually, I have been very consistent over the course of my entire life.
Are you supporting a campaign?
All right, easy now. Easy, we don't have time for that.
Are you running for office?
Brilliant.
Are the big candidates sucking all the air out of the room and you can't get your message out? Well, it's time to advertise on KCAA. Don't let your message get thrown in the trash can with all those flyers.
No.
Don't let your message fade into the background with all those signs. Get into the ears, the minds, and the hearts in KCAA's listening audience. Log on to our website at kcaaradio.com and give us a call. We've got great rates for local candidates because your message is important too.
Bing, bing, bong, bong, bing, bing, bing.
What have we done?
KCAA is your CNBC news affiliate. We're the station that gets down to business.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.
Welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you. The fascinating piece over at nj4transit.org/stuck-at-the-station. And this is a website, New Jersey for Transit, nj4transit.org. And it's a paper titled Stuck at the Station. And it's by Ryan Hall, staff analyst with the Tri-State Transportation Campaign. He points out that while the Long Island Railroad and Metro North, these New York railroads, have increased the average distance between failures by 922% and 2,875% respectively since 2000. In other words, failures are less and less frequent, train accidents and problems. New Jersey Transit has not kept up and has consistently lagged behind its regional peers. Now, why might that be? I you know, reading this, I'd say this is the Chris Christie crash. I mean, this is incredible. Capital investment in New Jersey Transit, ridership is up 20% since 2002. Capital investment is down 19.4% since 2002. So you've got more riders, less investment. What a surprise that there's no positive train control system in place in this. This is really, really remarkable. The investment in transit capital projects has declined by nearly 20% over the past 15 years and by nearly 30% since 2004 alone after adjusting for inflation. Investment in rail projects declined by 34% between 2003 and 2016 after adjusting for inflation, while investment in bus